Tervetuloa taas Kuningaskunnan tuuliohjelmasarjan pariin. Tässä jaksossa olemme keskellä länsirantaa. Länsimaat ajavat tänne Juudean ja Samarian alueelle palestiinalaisvaltiota. Tässä jaksossa katsomme, miltä tämä suunnitelma kahdesta valtiosta täällä paikan päällä näyttää.
I feel it's like became as a kids TV show, you know, when you play with the kids or you want to make them like feel their life is happy and these things. So you play with them like this is what we're gonna do and this is, and then you find everything is like just to feel, make you feel like you're a kid, you know, or a child. And this is what's happening. It's all the political game.
Muhammed Ayesh on Balatan pakolaisleirissä syntynyt ja kasvanut toisen polven palestiinalaispakolainen.
They play just this big game, you know, and the victims we are. The victims, as people, even from both sides, Palestinian or Israelis. I'm 100% sure that Israelis don't know what's going on in Israel, in Palestine or in Israel. They just voted because of the propaganda they see always on the TV by the media.
Maailma, Suomi mukaan lukien, äänesti Juudean ja Samarian alueen YK:n tarkkailijavaltioksi marraskuussa 2012.
Registered Palestine as a country in the United Nations, which is, I don't understand till today how we are like country, but we are not registered as a country, can vote or whatever. So how come this can accept it on my mentality? I don't understand what they want by that or what they mean.
Täällä paikan päällä koko ajatus Palestiinan valtiosta on huono vitsi, joka saa lähinnä länsimaat näyttämään naurettavilta.
We've been like talking about since 20 years ago now, or 23 now. And there is nothing happening. Recently we have the new hero of the savers in Palestine and Israel, which is Kerry, the American, whatever you called it. He wants us to have like, I don't know what kind of a state solution.
Kahden valtion ratkaisua eivät täällä länsirannalla ota vakavasti sen paremmin palestiinalaiset kuin juutalaisetkaan. Professori Abraham Sion on laki- ja mediakeskuksen johtaja Arielin yliopistossa Samariassa.
Unless the world understands the basic fact that the Arabs are not interested in a two-state solution and they are not interested in any Jewish state in this area, unless they understand that, they will live in a dream, in a fairy tale.
Tässä länsimaiden rakastamassa sadussa kaikki palestiinalaiset asutetaan siis onnellisesti länsimaiden tuella synnytettyyn palestiinalaisvaltioon. Sadunkertojien kannalta kiusallinen realiteetti on, että palestiinalaispakolaiset eivät halua tätä kahden valtion ratkaisua.
Maybe 5 or 10% of the refugees who live here, they believe like in two-state solution, but the rest they believe in their original town. They want one-state solution, which is belong to them, the Palestinian rights return. And that's why, so, I mean, as a refugee for me, I prefer one-state solution.
Palestiinalaisista näitä pakolaisia on 5 miljoonaa. Valtaosa heistä ei siis halua palestiinalaisvaltiota, vaan he haluavat muuttaa takaisin Israeliin, josta heidän isovanhempansa pakenivat Israelin itsenäistyessä. Kaikki arabit eivät kuitenkaan paenneet kodeistaan Israelin valtion itsenäistyessä, vaan osa jäi asumaan juutalaisten keskelle. Myöskään nämä Israelissa jo 65 vuotta asuneet arabit eivät kaipaa asumaan tähän palestiinalaisvaltioon.
They live in a democracy. They have much better terms than they have in any other Arab country and also in the Palestinian territory. Let me tell you that the Arabs under Israeli military control in Gaza, when I was there as a reserve soldier, officer, they had much more rights under Israeli military rule than they have at any time under the Palestinian rule or under the Gaza rule. So they were much better off at that time. 300,000 Arabs were working inside Israel. They got all the benefits that the Jews have, and it's 10 times more than the benefits they get when they work in the Arab territories.
Israelin armeijassa vapaaehtoisesti palvelevat kristityt arabit ovat myös vuoden 2013 aikana astuneet näkyville ja puhuvat Israelista kotimaanaan, joka on puolustamisen arvoinen. Myöskään Israelin puolelle asumaan jääneet islaminuskoiset arabit eivät ole halunneet vaihtaa palestiinalaishallinnon alle silloinkaan, kun sitä on heille tarjottu.
And you can see that when we offered the Arabs of the triangle, that's Taibe, the Arab villages close to the 67 borderline. We said, look, why don't you move? You don't move. We're not going to take you away. Just move the border. And instead of being under Israeli control, be under Palestinian control. They said, no, under no circumstances. We would not do that. We want to remain here.
Palestiinalaisvaltiota kannattaa osa niistä arabeista, jotka polveutuvat jo Israelin itsenäistyessä Juudean ja Samarian alueella asuneista arabeista. Palestiinalaisvaltiota kannattavat erityisesti palestiinalaisten johtajat ja heidän lähipiirinsä, jotka saavat siitä itselleen huikeaa taloudellista hyötyä. Esimerkiksi Abbas nauttii edelleen presidenttinä olemisesta ja presidenttinä saamastaan $1,000,000 kuukausipalkasta, siitäkin huolimatta, että hänen vaaleilla valittu toimikautensa päättyy jo tammikuussa 2009. Kahden valtion ratkaisua kannattavia länsimaita ei näytä häiritsevän edes se, että Abbas ei ole enää laillisesti vallassa, vaan palestiinalaisvaltiota valmistellaan hänen korruptoituneen hallintonsa kanssa.
I mean, this is the main issue too, the third hand which is playing a big role in the country, which is the European and the American, mainly the Americans. They play a big role. They talk about themselves as the democratic states where they destroy all the nation all over the world.
Palestiinalaiset kokevat olevansa muille pelkkiä pelinappuloita ja he ovat pettyneitä myös muihin arabimaihin.
Even in the Arabic country we have the same. They play with the Palestinian. Like Qatar. Since when Qatar care about Palestine? Just since when they start having their own interest in the Arabic countries. Saudi Arabia is the same. Egypt is the same. Lebanon is the same. They don't give a shit about us. They just care about themselves. I mean the borders between Israelis and Lebanon. When we have the war in Gaza, what did you do for Palestinian? Nothing. They were standing aside. But when they have a war with Lebanese, they wanted us to intervene to stop support, you know, to support them and stop Israel from attacking them. So all people is interested about themselves. So they don't care about whatever, us or Israelis. It's the same. It's just like corruption and money. That's all. I'm bored.
Palestiinalaisten pettymys arabimaihin syveni, kun Jordania karkoitti vuonna 70 vallankaappausta yrittäneen Palestiinan vapautusjärjestö PLO:n maasta. Tätä kutsutaan mustaksi syyskuuksi.
People saw at that time with the Arabic country was different view because of the national ID, the Arabic national ID. Everybody was expecting Jordan as a pro-Palestine. It's not going to be a government against Palestine. And so that's why what's happened at that time in 67, after the Black September, for example, war, all the Palestinian fighter was killed there by the Jordanian. So I don't understand how come you are going to be controlling me, or you want me to be following your country, or being a part of your country, or be a country with your relationship, you know, and then you're killing my people. So that's the problem. There is nothing called pro-Palestine. Or a country wants Palestine rights. All of them, they want their own benefits, their own interests. And this is what I believe. After 34 years of my experiences in this country, everybody cares about his own responsibility.
And this is my theory. If it was possible to take every Arab and ask him in a closed room where nobody is hearing, what does he prefer? To be under Palestinian rule, under Israeli rule, he would definitely have said, I would like to be under Israeli rule. But if he says that, then the next day he might not be alive. So therefore, you don't have people who are saying that they want to be under Israeli control, because this is like treason.
Palestiinan kansan vuoksi arabijohtajat eivät tätä kahden valtion ratkaisua tahdo. Mihin tätä palestiinalaisvaltiota sitten oikein tarvitaan? Vastausta ei tarvitse hakea kaukaa. Se löytyy Gaasasta. Kun Israel vetäytyi sieltä syyskuussa 2005, Gaasasta ei muodostunutkaan sen johdosta palestiinalaisten onnelaa, vaan tukikohta taistelussa Israelin tuhoamiseksi. Tavoite tuhota Israel lukee suoraan myös Gaasaa hallinnoivan Hamasin peruskirjassa. Israel on olemassa siihen asti, kunnes islam tuhoaa sen, samoin kuin se tuhosi muut ennen sitä. Palestiinalaisvaltion idea on saada Israelin armeija ulos myös länsirannalta, jotta myös tästä länsirannan rajalta voitaisiin käydä sotaa Israelia vastaan.
Well, first of all, we have to understand one basic thing. the Arabs would not accept a Jewish state under no circumstances, under no circumstances. In other words, it's not a war for territory. It's a war of religion. It's a war that the Arabs cannot accept the fact that in the center of the Arab world, there is a Jewish state. They would not accept it. That's why they do not, they would not recognize Israel as Jewish state. What's the problem of recognizing Israel as a Jewish state?
Myös kahden valtion ratkaisua ja palestiinalaisvaltion perustamista ajava Yhdysvallat oli maaliskuussa 2014 edelleen julkisuudessa sitä mieltä, ettei palestiinalaisten ole tarvetta tunnustaa Israelia juutalaisena valtiona.
You know, when President Bush, when he was in power, he said, within 1 year there's going to be peace. I am going to make peace within 1 year. Well, what happened? Nothing. And then comes President Obama and says, within 1 year we're going to have peace here. He doesn't know the facts. He doesn't understand the facts. I mean, the Americans have such great intelligence by knowing what's happening in the world. They even know what Angela Merkel is speaking in a telephone. But when it comes to putting this in order and trying to find out what's the bottom line, they know nothing. And when they still believe that you can have peace with somebody who wants to eat you up, then they don't understand the basic thing of the situation in this area.
Suomi esitti YK:n yleiskokoukselle kansallisessa puheenvuorossaan syyskuussa 2013 kahden valtion ratkaisua tukevan kantansa. 20 vuotta sitten solmitun Oslon sopimuksen jälkeen on ollut selvää, että paras tulos kaikille osapuolille on kahden valtion ratkaisu, joka pystyy saamaan aikaan rauhan ja turvallisuuden aikakauden kahdelle kansalle. Suomalaisen ulkopolitiikan usko rauhan ja turvallisuuden tuovasta kahden valtion ratkaisusta on siis kovin kaukana alueen todellisuudesta, sillä rauhanomainen rinnakkaiselo ei kuulu arabijohtajien tavoitteisiin. Kahden valtion ratkaisu on palestiinalaisjohtajille vain välivaihe Israelin tuhoamiseksi.
They would not accept a two-state solution. That's why nothing is going on. Israel is offering every possible thing. You understand now that they are asking for the release of more terrorists. That's what they want. They want the release of more terrorists. They're not really negotiating. They're not really trying to come to any terms of peace. And terrorism is continuing everywhere. Terrorism, which is the basic of the Oslo Agreement, is null, is nil. It's not effective at all. And the only reason why we do not have terrorists or terrorism in this area or within the Green Line is only for one reason, because of the IDF. The IDF is everywhere here. When the IDF was out of Judea and Samaria, then there was a lot of terror. Now it's different only because the IDF is here, and the IDF really is helping the Palestinian Authority to survive. If the IDF was not in this area, the Hamas would have taken over and we would have a worse terrorist situation.
Kesäkuuhun 67 asti Judea ja Samaria olivat Jordanian vallan alla. Arabeilla oli silloin hallinnassaan kaikki se, mitä he nyt palestiinalaisvaltiolle vaativat. Sinä aikana kukaan ei kuitenkaan tahtonut alueelle palestiinalaisvaltiota eikä Jerusalemia sen pääkaupungiksi. Palestiinan kansallissopimuksen toinen artikla sekä vuoden 64 että 68 sopimuksissa kuuluu nimittäin näin. Palestiina niillä rajoilla, jotka sillä oli brittimandaatin aikana, on jakamaton alueellinen yksikkö. Vuoden 49 aselepolinjan eli niin sanotun vihreän linjan sisällä asuu noin 5 miljoonaa juutalaista ja 1,7 miljoonaa arabia. Lisäksi 500 000 juutalaista asuu Itä-Jerusalemissa ja Länsirannalla. Länsirannalla Gaasassa ja Jordaniassa asuvista arabeista merkittävä osa puolestaan on vuoden 1948 pakolaisia ja heidän jälkeläisiään. Palestiinalaishallinnon vaatima kahden valtion ratkaisu tarkoittaisi ensinnäkin sitä, että kaikki juutalaiset siirrettäisiin vihreän linjan sisään. Lisäksi he vaativat kaikille näiden alueiden ja ympäröivien maiden vuoden 1948 palestiinalaispakolaisille oikeutta saada muuttaa saman vihreän linjan sisään. Lopputuloksena olisi siis arabienemmistöinen Israel. Suunnitellun palestiinalaisvaltion sisään sen sijaan jäisi vain pieni osa palestiinalaisista. Juutalaisvaltiota ei sitten enää olisi.
So at the moment they are aiming at four states that will become one: Jordan, Gaza, the West Bank, and then the Israel in the tiny Israel within the green line, and then they will finish their problem.
Mikään määrä valtioita ei nimittäin ratkaise todellista ongelmaa.
Unless the Arabs accept the Jewish state, there will not be peace. Once they accept the Jewish state, they accept, really accept, not just say we accept, really accept. They come to terms with themselves and say, look, we cannot annihilate the Jewish state. We cannot throw them out in the sea. Let's live with them. Once this happens, there will be peace.
Länsimaiden hyväntahtoiset pyrkimykset alueella vain pahentavat tilannetta, koska ne yrittävät ratkaista aivan väärää ongelmaa. Lähi-idän ongelma ei nimittäin ole Israel, vaan arabien keskuudessa elävä vihankulttuuri. Muhammed Ayeshin perhe lähti Israelin itsenäistyessä pakoon Haifan seudulta ja juuttui Balatan pakolaisleirille. Muhammed on syntynyt ja kasvanut siellä. Juutalainen Abraham Sion on myös pakolainen. Hänen sukunsa asui Irakin alueella liki 2000 vuotta Jerusalemin toisen temppelin tuhosta asti. Israelin itsenäistymisen jälkeen Sionin perhe joutui pakenemaan Irakista ja Abraham tuli Israeliin 11-vuotiaana.
It was difficult to come here first of all because you get uprooted from your own place and you come to a new place. Of course, we felt at home, but it was very, very difficult at the beginning. My father had a lot of property. He was a rich man in Iraq, and he left all the property there. He hardly was able to get something out. So you can imagine what is it to live in luxury in a place and then to come to a place where you start living in tents and until you get settled. It takes quite a lot of time. But things changed in 10-15 years and for the better. And I don't regret one minute that I'm here.
Ennen Oslon sopimuksia ja intifaadoja Juudean ja Samarian alueella asuvat arabit ja juutalaiset pystyivät elämään yhdessä.
Before this intifada started and the first intifada on the 1980s, I don't know, 70% of the population used to work in Israel. So how come you consider this your enemy if you work there and they pay you? 90% of the is a Palestinian economical situation used to depend on the Israeli one. So what kind of enemies? But these are the brainwashed, happened later after like Oslo agreements, you know, create this hateness, create more enemies between each other. And the people who get this benefit is the corrupted people and the governments. They have the corruption, they have the power, they can use it as the ones and they can do whatever they want for both nations, not for us just.
Well, it's the same thing as in Iraq, in Syria, in Lebanon, in Egypt. The people don't count. When you have a totalitarian state, the people do not count. So you have the leaders who decide what's happening and the people go along because they cannot say anything which is against. The next day they are either in prison or they're dead.
Tämä Juudean ja Samarian alue on Oslon sopimuksella jaettu niin, että juutalaisten pääsy arabikyliin ja kaupunkeihin ja niiden välisille teille on kielletty. Palestiinalaisilla rekisterikilvillä varustetut autot eivät puolestaan pääse juutalaisille asutusalueille ja esimerkiksi Arieliin töihin tulevat arabit jättävät autonsa portin ulkopuolelle. Kun Arielin kaupunkiin valmistui vuonna 2003 tämä uusi tie, siitä ei tehty edes virallista liittymää tälle arabikyliä yhdistävälle tielle. Arabien ja juutalaisten tarve päästä toistensa luo on kuitenkin synnyttänyt pikkutien näiden virallisten teiden välille. Arjen tasolla yhteys pyrkii aina syntymään, vaikka kummoisessa kunnossa se ei ole, ennen kuin todellinen rauha tulee.
Jews and Arabs will have to live side by side in a situation that is today. In other words, in the one hand, we should try to bring them closer to our hearts as much as we can, because not all Arabs are bad and not all Arabs want to fight us.
I want to clarify one thing about Palestine and about the Israelis and about the whole conflict here. We are a human before anything else, you know? We want to live as normal life, as you in Finland, as the other people in Germany, as the other people in the Arab country. We are all have to have the same lifestyle, you know? We don't have any hateness for any person.
Juutalaiset käyvät Arielin lähellä arabikaupoissa ja arabit käyvät töissä Arielissa. Tavalliset ihmiset haluavat elää normaalia elämää ja elättää perheensä.
If you leave the situation for nations, for people themselves, like here and there, they will live together. They don't care about whatever. None of them know me or I know them. Yani, let's say you are an Israelis and we met the first time and you don't know me, I'm a Palestinian and I don't know that you are an Israelis, I will never have any problem with you. You know, because we never know each other. We are human before anything else. But if I knew like you are an Israelis before and you know that I'm a Palestinian, we still have these borders that we created by ourselves, even by our Palestinian or Israelis, where they like teach you or filling you with these hateness for Arab Palestinian Muslims. And the same for Muslim, for Palestinian. They hate you, or they feel of filling you with these hateness for Israelis. They are your enemies and stuff like that. And that's why it's like unbelievable. Yani, I'm going to tell you like a quick story about what happened with me when I was in Germany, like about a month and a half now, or 2 months nearly. When I arrived to Basel airport, we were like a group of Palestinians and a group of Israelis and international, like German, you know, in this conference. We asked the taxi driver, are we ready? He said, there is one over there and we're still missing another person. He will come soon. So we said, okay, we're going to just go and say hi. We didn't know that he's an Israeli and he didn't know that we are Palestinian. Of course, we speak English, all of us. So we said, hi, how are you? Like, nice meeting you. And Mayash from Nablus, whatever. And he said, I'm Shlomo from, I think he was living in Tel Aviv. And at this point, we didn't know each other, you know, like, look at him, like, hi, saying hi and shaking hands is like, fine. But then when you know, like, he's an Israeli, you feel like, oops, Israelis, it's like, and he's like Palestinian, you know. And then when you start like talking and have a conversation and have this culture of, which we call it the dialogue culture, you know, which is one of the most effective way to show the reality for both nations. I mean, this is the major issues. Dialogues and talks always make people more closer. And this is why we became more friends, me and them. I mean, like, I have Michal, she's a good friend of mine, and she was ex-soldiers now. We Skype all the time. We talk by the phone. We Skype, we text each other, like, hi, how are you? How was your weekend? What did you do? What, whatever, you know, all these kind of questions. And we still like together. And actually, I mean, this is an interesting for you as an experience, you know, after such a long time of, you know, having these problems, and then you find these people like similar to you, you know, but they've been brainwashed and you've been brainwashed too. So you change your mind, twisted your mind 90% degree.
Muhammad toimii saksalaisten johtamassa Friendship Across Borders -järjestössä, jonka tavoitteena on henkilökohtaisten kohtaamisien kautta saada juutalaiset ja palestiinalaiset ihmisinä löytämään toisensa.
The last meeting we have, it was next to Jericho. We had it with like Palestinian and Israelis just, and we had a friend of us which is called Deb Brech, and she had a book which is an interesting book called No More Enemies. You know, I'm reading it still now, which is talking about the Palestinian, you know, and Israelis ideological problems, issues of enemies and stuff. There is no enemy, basically. Yani, if I meet you in Europe and you are an Israeli, we don't have any problems. But here is like, we create these enemies for ourselves. Like, as long as you are Israeli, you are my enemy. As long as you are Palestinian, you are my enemy. So this is the way how we create for each other enemies. And there is no enemies. We are human before anything else. Even if you are Muslims, Jewish, Palestinian, whatever. My identity is I'm Palestinian, Arabic, Muslim. Your identity is Israelis, Jewish, whatever, you know? So there is no problem before anything else. We're a human. So we created these issues. We create these hitness. We create these problems, you know. So that's why it's like too complicated for people to understand it right now, and especially as a refugee for me, and to live in Balata, and which is the biggest refugee in West Bank. And let's say go and telling them like, listen, we're going to have one state solution. They look at me like, what are you talking about? How come we're going to have one state with these enemies? I don't think these are my enemies.
Muhammed on turhautunut siihen poliittiseen peliin, jota ihmiset käyvät. Viime ajat hän on suunnannut tarmonsa vapaaehtoistyöhön klinikalle, jossa hoidetaan kolhiintuneita aaseja. Ihmisten pelaaminen päättyy kerran. Raamatussa Jumalalla on lupaus siitä, miten tähän maahan tulee rauha. Jumala erityisesti varoittaa Raamatussa kansoja jakamasta hänen maataan. Minä kokoan kaikki kansat ja vien ne alas Joosafatin laaksoon. Siellä minä käyn oikeutta niitä vastaan, kansani ja perintöosani Israelin tähden, koska ne ovat hajottaneet kansani kansojen sekaan, jakaneet minun maani. Jumala nimittäin on luvannut tämän maan Jaakobille eli Israelille. Sen maan, jonka olen antanut Abrahamille ja Iisakille, minä annan sinulle ja sinun jälkeesi minä annan sen sinun jälkeläisillesi. Raamattu kertoo tulossa olevasta rauhan ajasta, joka koittaa, kun Israelin kaikki 12 heimoa ovat palanneet takaisin maahansa ja maata hallitsee juutalainen messiaskuningas. Jakakaa tämä maa keskenänne Israelin sukukuntien mukaan ja arpokaa se perinnöksi itsellenne ja muukalaisille, jotka asuvat teidän keskuudessanne ja ovat synnyttäneet lapsia teidän keskuudessanne. Olkoot he teille samanarvoisia kuin maassa syntyneet israelilaiset. He saakoot arvalla perintöosan Israelin sukukuntain keskuudessa teidän kanssanne. Missä sukukunnassa muukalainen asuu, siinä antakaa hänelle perintöosa, sanoo Herra, Herra. Rukoillaan vielä yhdessä. Kiitos Isä siitä, että sinun suunnitelmasi on hyvä. Kiitos siitä, että se on hyvä kaikille. Isä, minä rukoilen, että myös meidän maamme voi löytää paikkansa tässä sinun suunnitelmassasi. Isä Jeesuksen nimessä, aamen.